So, according to the IMF, International Monetary Fund, terrorists were not involved to solicitation. Yeah, the light is in the black. You need the light?
That's what it is. No, I saw it. They were trying to get some. I thought they needed it.
Could you, you want to come over?
She said she thinks someone from the detective here got the light.
Oh,
yeah,
you need to come
yeah.
Probably
the
close. We started working on the cartoon, like in class. From class, we did close.
No, that's
the detective. No, that's the detective.
Oh, yeah, I apologize for that. So according to the IMF, this is the international body, monetary body, terrorist financing involves the solicitation of people and seek the collection or provision of funds with the intent that they may be used to support terrorist acts or organizations. Funds stem from both legal and illicit sources. Don't worry about that, I'll expand on that later. Terrorists need to pay for stuff, like I started to say earlier, like meals. Transportation, training, weapon. You can't go on the black market and get explosive items on credit. You know why? You're going to blow up yourself. I bet you can pay me back. So you have to have money, yeah? To get these explosives and weapons and all that good stuff and resources. Simply put, you need funds to carry your terrorist acts. Even if it's a small terrorist act, when you're going to just rent a car to go drive up to government house and blow up, or you're going to rent a car, or yeah, to run over some people or rent or whatever. Even let me give a case in point. Everyone remember the Boston Marathon, 2014. Two brothers were involved. I followed the FBI's investigation, and those two brothers, you know, with those debit cards, that's your whole life on that. When they went into Walmart and they purchased the fertilizer, the nails, and the microwaves, and you swiped that, you know that that's a record. Right. And when they went to the train station and they swiped to get there, that's a record. So the FBI was able to put a timeline on where they went, what they purchased, where they were at, and when they got a snack. So the snack, the Walmart, and the train station, they knew where they were based on the timeline. So those same stuff like your debit card, that could say what you like, what you do, your habits, everything is on that little metal strip on your statements. Yeah? No, you get the presentation. I'm giving you this. This is something I put together.
Okay, so you're
going to
give us that?
Yeah, if you want it. Yeah, it's free. You can get an email to you or you can copy it today. It's free. Yeah. Because I looked at what you have in here, the 12 pages, and I sort of expanded on it a bit, and I put my little spin on it.
I know, but you don't have it
for
that far.
Right now?
Yeah.
No. I only have three copies. So I can email it to you. Yeah, I'll give you my word, scouts on, or we can print it. Either way. Like I said, terrorists require money. Yeah? Hey, how you doing? Anyway, you can get a little seat, and don't forget to sign the register before you leave. Has anyone here ever heard of a wallet? When you're a terrorist, you gotta be able to move money. And we talk about moving money, and it's not just domestic or local. You need to be able to move money worldwide. And there's a term that perhaps when you do your paper or your exam, you could perhaps incorporate that in that. You can move money almost anonymously by this system called a wallet. A wallet really means in Arabic, means to transfer. That's another way of saying transfer. It's an informal. So it ain't like when you go to Western Union and put all that paperwork. This one here is based on trust. I trust you. You trust me. Yeah? So it's paperless. A wallet is a system or agency for transferring money traditionally used in the Muslim community. It's not solely in the Muslim community, but they predominantly... Oh, they've done it already? Okay, cool. Let me make sure this ain't the one I have. Yeah. So everyone can get a copy. So with the, like I said, with the wallet, I'm not picking on anyone by referencing the Muslim faith, okay? Because I was in another setting and I mentioned some radical Muslims. And who ain't gonna report it on to my boss? That snitch in the class go on and call and tell my boss, I said that all Jamaicans are terrorists. Wow. I never said that. It just so happens that whenever you read the newspaper or the press and media, it's predominantly Muslims who's doing it. So I referenced that. And I always have the little caveat that, hey, I'm only referencing them because it's predominantly in the newspaper and the press. When was the last time you saw a Christian fly plane in the building? You don't see that every day, right? Mm-hmm. But you hear, how many times have you heard of Muslims blowing up people or running over people or claiming ISIS or whatever? Okay, so that was the only reason why I referenced them. This is a system that they use to secretly send money. And it's based on trust. I trust you, you trust me, and I took care of it. There's someone in Carolina I need to get $200 to. So I give you $200. You call your agent in Carolina and he's listen here, I need you to give John Brown $200. He gives that person $200. And the way you get your money back is whenever you see him again, they keep a little log or register or whatever. Or that person in Carolina puts up what they call a front company or business. And he would send a product or item to that person for sale and you would inflate the difference. So they'd get their commission plus the yeah, but it's a system really not really paper. It's paper, a lot of paper to trace back to the poison. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So because of this, it's hard to detect.
You can detect that
because it's paperless and it's one based on trust. And if it's me and you, I never give you no money. I never send you no money. Who's the poison on the next end? What you talking about? You ain't got no paper. Yeah. So this is one of the biggest hurdles for investigators when it comes down to terrorist financing. No paper. Yeah. You can feel free to reference that. It's pretty cool. Good. It costs money to carry the terrorist act. This may not be in your pamphlet there, but I included it. Let me give you some examples. The London transport system. That was a bombing. This is back in 2005, July 7th. The cost, $28,000. Not a lot of money, but you could kill 164 people within your act. Yeah, it ain't the amount of money, it's how you utilize the resources that you obtain. Yeah, because with the two brothers in Boston Marathon, they use the fertilizer, the nails, and the microwaves. What happens when you put nails in a microwave? Metal. It's gonna combust, it's gonna explode. And fertilizer gives it that extra power and also its stickability, it sticks. You ever hear people say, I'll throw hot bricks on you?
Yeah.
Well, if you put the fertilizer there with the nails, it's gonna cause what they call shrapnel when it explodes and that's gonna stick.
Wow.
So making a bomb is easy. All you need is fertilizer, some nails from Kelly's and a microwave. Well, I ain't telling you all to do like crazy, don't get me wrong. I'm saying it's
easy. Plug the microwave in.
No, they had it on remote time. They had a battery pack with a sauce. And they think about it, they went to Walmart to get everything they needed. Walmart. But of course, with the debit card, that's how they're able to trace them. And the interesting thing is that the FBI had them on a watch list for a while. They didn't have any in concrete, but they were on their watch list. That's another thing you got to be mindful of with terrorists. We do have watch lists. So, then we have the Madrid train bombing. Only $10,000. And that, by the way, that 10,000 is in pounds. I didn't know how to do the pounds and the euros. But it's 10,000 pounds, that was 2004. Istanbul truck bomb attacks, $40,000 US. And you're talking about in the average, you're talking about outside of the US code, you're talking about 100 plus people. Now that's a lot of lives for $10,000, $8,000. I mean, you see why we take this thing serious? Hey, you know, trying to get near you. So and then we have the Jakarta Marriott Hotel. So you go on vacation, you down in Jakarta chilling up. You know, Bahamas. You maybe didn't go further, man. But if you do happen to go to Jakarta, you're down there chilling out. And all of a sudden, you place blow up. Suddenly, you lose $30,000 to buy the explosives and this AK-47 on the rampage. The Bali bombings. $2,250,000. Again, more than 100 poison. It looked like that's standard at 100. Because you're talking about radical people who got these extreme beliefs. And the greater the impact, the further they advance their cause. Because if you just kill 2 people, ain't nothing to that. But if you kill 100 people, you can be on CNN tonight. And it can be a big story, and it can bring attention to your cause. Yeah? So the more damage, of course, we know 9/11. I mean, that's the creme de la creme. Can't trump that. The USS Cole, you remember that exercise was in 2000 when the guys, they pulled up on the boat, the king, next to the destroyer, and they paid the soldiers, say, hey, how you all doing? And they thought it was just some regular civilians passing, and then they detonated the boat.
You mean the
You all remember that? Back in 2000?
The day
after. They put this big hole inside the destroyed US destroyer.
He coming over.
These guys, they just go passing and they say, hey, how you doing? And then they blow themselves up. How do you fight someone who's gonna blow themselves up? How do you fight someone who's ready to die? You can't try to have a jail time. Oh, no, man. Dude, I'm getting ready to blow myself up. You can't deliver that. So that only cost $10,000. Al-Qaeda, of course, spent roughly $500,000, about 500 grand, to destroy the World Trade Center, the symbol of international finance in the United States, and cripple the Pentagon on top of that. What did it cost the United States? $3.3 trillion. Yeah, but I'm going someplace with this. It cost the United States $3.3 trillion, but what did it cost the world? You can tell me why I said that? When you travel, you gotta take your shoes off. You gotta, I went to Colombia the other day. It was a money laundering exercise. I was going through the US border protection. I said, oh, I'm going to Colombia. Oh, you're going to Colombia, what you gonna do? I'm gonna learn about money laundering. The fellas, oh, interesting, could I come in the little room? I say, is there some problem? He said, no, we're just interested in, you know, this was when I was at the FIU. And I had to say, hey, no, I'm one of the good guys. No, I'm in law enforcement at the FIU. He said, oh, okay, because, you know, you're going to study money laundering and all that stuff. Then he said, okay, no problem. Could you just go over there? And then they had the dog smell me, and then they swab my hand with that. The cost of travel on it. 3 hours ahead, they swab in your hand now. Liquid and stuff. I saw this machine coming back from New York just the 3 weeks ago. The lady, she was going through all this swabs, and they have this field kit that they can put. They can do field analysis real quick. And she's putting it at the computer, and I said, look at this foolishness. And I said, wow.
Were they
scanning for particles? For possible explosives particles? And she said, oh, I'm just checking to make sure you know many explosives. I said, miss, trust me, every bomb is, we don't know about it. We won't get to the States and get back when our money goes. We ain't all that. And you won't get a paper cut. So we ain't there. So she said, I'm checking, son, doing my job. I said, yeah, check. Did I do your retina scan? All of those, when you go, they tell you, stand in with a CI. That goes into the FBI database. So any one of you who traveled before, your retina scans are in Washington. Your fingerprints are in the FBI database. Look into the camera and all that good stuff. Ain't like they, if you travel before, they already have.
So why is that?
They always ask you that. They have something called
stress
conditioning. They have series of questions they pose to you. It's a stress test. They ask you questions like, where are you going? How long are you going to be? They pretty much know them to see if it's consistent. You know, if you're nervous or you're panic. You know, see that the young lady the other day who's going to the airport with a 2 pound of cocaine in her hair.
Yeah.
And they think about it, they know something was wrong because she just keep doing this. And they were like, and she was just going in. They say, you know what? We need to talk to you in the little room. And then you know the little stitching thing,
mm-hmm.
It was starting to leak, whatever that thing, you know. And it's like, you know, being the dog came in and they smelled it, and they did field tests because when they did it's a little solution that DU has, because I used to work in DU, I know. They do the sample, you drop it in. Once that turned blue, okay, it's positive for cocaine. So what's she gonna tell the police? You got 2 pounds of cocaine in your hand. Whoops! How did you get 2 pounds of cocaine in your hand? That could have been explosives. You see why they take this stuff serious? You know? But it is what it is. She ain't gonna stay no more. You could, she's on the southwest. So you could, if she have a visa, well, that's canceled indefinitely. So don't play around with your visa. You know, take stuff like that. Like, let me give you another case in point. I was coming through LaGuardia, again, like I told you on the vacation. It was a 70-plus Jewish man, year-old Jewish man. He was on standby, and he was in the airport. We were trying to get into Fort Lauderdale, coming back on the vacation. Apparently, he couldn't get onto this flight. So he made a big stand. He said, you know what? I'll blow this plane up. Look here, you look certain things you don't say in the airport. You don't even joke or stuff tonight with these fellas come running out of nowhere with these SWAT masks on. I said, what the hell? They been hiding and they really come from. Fellas came in, fellas with AR-15 and all kind of mini 14 rifles. I said, what the hell? The airport got closed down 3 hours. You can look it up in the newspaper. You got your phone, look at a 75-year-old man to go out of the airport. And I said, what the hell? Why? He couldn't get on this plane, so he got frustrated. I'll blow this plane up. You don't joke or stuff like that. Yeah, what? You don't make eye contact because they have a quota. They have to do random sampling. You know, and I said, I'm the only black guy in this plane. Please don't make me up there. Sorry, could you come over here? Damn! Black people don't blow this plane. I can't say that. Well, I'm black man. You know? Nobody. Patsy's up. Nobody like life too much. But
so
it is
Mr.
what
Taylor,
it is.
I have a question.
Yes,
like,
please come to the
question. Why do you think they didn't just let her board and pull her on the other side?
Why didn't let her board?
Uh-huh.
No, because you're soliciting the transfer of drugs. If you got her right there, you lock her up. You need to find out who she's carrying that from. She was testing it. Yep. They passed the information on to the excise. Hey, this person was on this flight. Probably the set of things to see who's going to come there.
Yeah, that's why I was funny.
If you got, it's almost like you got a show in. So that's a number code. Okay, it's like you got a sure thing. You know, I got this poison in possession. That's a sure case. That's open. That's a slam dunk. So I got a 2 pounds of cocaine in your hair. That's a sure case.
So did she get,
you know, letting her go over there and whatever. I don't know what happened. And furthermore, I could get some good intelligence from that. You know? And she was singing. She started talking and saying, you know, this fella promised her 18,000. So, I mean, you know. Even when I was in the U.S., we used to go to the airport, they got what we call the swallowers. When we go to the airport, you would find these people. There was a young lady, she was going over and being, and he was like, curious, like, okay. So take her to the PMH. We run the x-ray. She had at least 20 of the condoms with the cocaine. She swallowed them. They swallowed it, drank some water, condom oil, and she had it in the system of one voice. Mm-hmm. Ain't nothing like having cocaine in your system and it's a way. She started
die.
You could die. But if she get over, she could get a couple thousand dollars over.
But if you dead.
Well, listen here, if you got 10 children, you're brand new, and you got a lot of stress going on, the last thing on your mind is cocaine voice in my stomach. But then you gotta remember you have hydrochloric acid in your stomach. And that's the powerful stuff. So a little condom packet that'll roll that real quick. And when that works, they stole it off. We also had the poison suit with the crevice, they would just push it in the rectum, a couple of packets.
Is this a guy?
Hey,
exactly.
And you scan that every day. Well, no, I don't do that no more. Because I remember when we used to go to the hospital with those guys, and you know, the doctor gave him some solution, and they don't want to cut the fellow's stomach. You got to read on him to pass, and you're in the bathroom, and you just hurry up, man, and you got to go to the school and get that out. And all that. It's like, I gotta get compliance, man. I can't be fooling. This ain't no make no sense. It's not a way to make a living. But it is what it is. And people do it every day, and people do get it every day. But then you people have voices who actually die. You know, you have voices who they talk all over, and you're like, what was the cause of that? Cocaine overdose. Poison never took cocaine in his life. This is his stomach, though. And, you know, that was the cause. It happens. I think about it. You only got to get to the airport from here to Fort Lauderdale and back, and you can get an easy $5,000. You think about your life. Yeah. It is what it is. But so it does cost money to carry the terrorist act. You don't have to have a lot of money, but you need some kind of funding. Investigators love when they use these products at banks and financial centers. Definitely, because you upload them anywhere. And you know, you could international movement of funds really fast. Yeah. Stuff like that. Even with your money grams. They love those kind of stuff. So people always think with terrorism, you know, like, oh, where's the money come from? I mean, if you can do carry the terrorist back, you gotta have money. But the money gotta come from somewhere. And these are just some examples of where the money would come from. It could come from perhaps illegal drug trade. It's still booming, by the way, in Bahamas. If you thought it was, you know, the 80s are coming back. So don't let anyone fool you. Whenever you have a depressed economy, what do we normally turn to? Drugs. Because we are a transshipment point between the United States and South America. We don't make the coke and the stuff. It comes from South America, predominantly Colombia, Mexico, because we're just, what, 40 minutes away from Florida? We're a transshipment point. And that ain't a change. We always say, yeah, we're right close to the United States. We get it. The 20 minutes. The rest of the world saying that too. And the drug dealer said, you know what? I can get my drugs in there. Quick too. So who do you use? Quick story. I know, please excuse me, I do a lot of flashbacks. Back in the early 80s, the Colombians, predominantly the Leader brothers, Carlos and Julio, you all heard those names before. You know those guys who are cheap. When the Colombians were flying, and I heard a lot of some of my colleagues talk these stories, when the Colombians plane, they needed to refuel, they would land in Guayaquil or some remote family island. And they would say, hey, look here, we got coke on the plane. We just gonna pass them through, you got the United States. You got a choice. You didn't get my bullets, or you get a couple of dollars. What you want? You're the only two police on the whole island, and you got a plane full of Colombians. What do you do? They said, you can accept my bullets, or you let me fly through and you get a couple of dollars a day. And a lot of police got corrupted by the names. That ain't no fit, because you know there was a commission inquiry. Everyone know about that. Who came out of it? And the Leader brothers were doing that a lot. And it's no secret. Even though we try to gloss it over and say, no, come on, man, not a whole freaking island. We live on it. So, fraud is a means of getting money to fund terrorist acts. We have corruption, forgeries, identity theft is booming, especially with those debit cards. I saw one of our ATMs, Carl Harbour, for experience. They totally ransacked that. They yanked all the face off. It is so full. It's an actual safe in the machine.
Yeah.
It's the same. They told you tear the face off and you yank all the wires. It's full of money. It's a safe in there after that. And after they saw that, they got mad. We saw a fellow on the footage kicking the machine. Yes, and Carla.
You can just put that there.
And we saw the camera with the fellas there, you know, and this was right before the storm. And they always hit right before the storm. You're like, okay, storm coming. Boy, ain't no police around. You try it. Ain't no money. Just a stupid safe.
And people were doing boss machines in the house.
Yeah, so that's what we got to deal with. So my boss made a decision. You know what? We ain't putting that in the car lab. It's there. We need to have the reassurance that they're going to have 24-hour security. They have a security there. But let's be real. After 12, and they're narrowing down now, you think there's a 24-hour security walking around here? Get to sleep just like us. Mm-hmm. So tax and robberies is another way to get terrorist funding. Illegal firearm sales. Does anyone believe in the illegal firearms in the Bahamas?
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Mm-hmm. They already covered enough bullets for this year for everyone in the Bahamas to get you. That's how much bullets they don't get. All we got is bullets and guns. And that can change them. You got 3,000 police officers. You have 700 islands and keys. And we have more than 1,000 entry points.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know the math. Can you effectively police all those points? No. Extortion, human smuggling, tax evasion. So all those, what we call predicate offenses, can be used to get monies to carry possible terrorist acts. Yeah. There you go. So, I had the previous slides that to be continued because they were all bad. Yeah, they were all criminal activity. Terrorist financing, it doesn't have to come from It can come, that's what is so mind-boggling, and it's hard to detect. It can come from good source as well as bad source. So one thing you remember from this class with terrorist financing, you can have someone who is a radical. Yeah? Let me give you a case in point. You remember the guy with the disco? I think it was 2 years now, and he shot 50 people in the United States and Florida. Mm-hmm. He said he's killing all the gay people. Mm-hmm. They said that he was the morning employee. He loved the work at least a half hour. He loved everybody. They said he was so efficient. He was the best security guard they could ever have. But his family said something, painted a different picture. They said when he got home, he said that he wanted all gays dead, anyone who didn't believe in Allah should die 10,000 times and all kinds of stuff. They say he just let a light switch and click, But at work, he was the perfect employee. So he got his money's legitimacy. And something really wrong with a fellow when he had 24 guns. I mean, you get one or two. But 24 guns? I mean, you may be a collector, but 24 handguns? If your husband got like 24 guns, you start to wonder, honey, you think you got enough? You think you need... So it can also come from legitimate sources such as charities. Charities is a big way of getting charities. So anybody here but these charities, have anyone ever seen these charities like 2 o'clock in the morning, you can't sleep. It's a commercial that comes on saying, you can feed a child. Yeah. In some country, you never able to $20 a month. We can send you a photograph. You don't know this child. You ain't got no material, whatever. You don't even know this country even exists. But every month, a religious leader sending $20 to fund this child who you probably have never seen. How you know you ain't for this child? How you know you ain't sending money to support some terrorist? Yeah. Maybe. Yeah. You just never know. Philanthropy. You got some folks there. You got them people who just rich and they're like, I want to do good. Wake up tomorrow morning and say, I want to give $10,000 to save all the dogs in Pakistan. Or I want to save the whole world. People got money. Money ain't got nothing to do with time. Those philanthropists, they can be unwittingly giving money to terrorist activity. Fundraisers again. Well, but us in the Bahamas now, trust me. No cocos anger and no terrorist activity now. You normally it's a medical fund or someone got something serious going on. It ain't gonna be for no terrorist activity. But then again, you never know. Donors again, just as such a your philanthropist. Legal gain from employment. You could have a job that's you're getting a legal salary and gainful employment, but however you have these radical beliefs and you want to advance the cause. You're hearing a lot of these fellows who are trying to get credit saying, this is advanced ISIS or whatever, that's why I did it. But they were using legal funds. How do you think I can get up every morning? Go to work on a job where people are carrying me to war, put in 45 hours a week, and then I'm going to put half, 3/4 of my salary into some cause. I know why that goes to some country for someone to go blow up his head. You got to be crazy. Not Patsy, son. Mm-hmm. So, gainful employment, investments. People just invest in stocks and bonds and use the residual or dividends to help advance these stores. And their gifts. And this is why I always, when I see at First Caribbean these transactions and I question them, well, why is this person sending this money to this person? Oh, it's a gift. I say, really? $100,000? Ain't no one ever sent me $1,000. I said, who's giving anyone $100,000? Yes. So I, KYC due diligence. I be suspicious. Even if you have the means, I need to know why. Why are you sending someone $100,000 as a gift? We had a scenario. Well, I can't talk the bank business, but let's just say y'all in the park. I can trust you, all right?
I got
right. Next thing one day I have a job. No, I can talk that one then. But we have same scenarios. We have some folks, the gifts. You said I love it in MoneyGrams. Mm-hmm. This just was a gift from someone. I want to gift someone. And when you start seeing $20,000, but you don't want $20,000, it's too tough.
So what is the reason for
that? My issue has always been support. You could say it's a gift. But show me support. I need to have the KYC on that person who's sending that money. They have the means, and there's no adverse information on them. I need to know who that person is. John Doe can just say, what's your name? John Doe can come to me and just say, I won't send Caitlin $10,000 because she just stirred my coffee. It ain't happening. I need to know you have a job. you have the finances, you, there's nothing adverse about you, negative press, you know, stuff like that. I need to build a case on you. I need a KYC on you. Almost as I need a, yeah. Oh yeah, oh no, I need to know who you are. And you know that Credit Suisse. And you see this kind of money moving around.
You can't, even with the money grounds, you can't spend more than $5,000.
But then when you start seeing the pattern where someone come to me, and say, I want to send a gift for $5,000. To this point, they come back the next day, I want to send another $5,000. What kind of gift?
Even with the system, with the money ground system, they have, like, they have it set up where you can see when it's the last time you send to the person and how much you spend anyway. So the customer service person can understand.
Y'all got that? Y'all heard that from money grounds?
Yeah.
So you, the 5,000 is the limit.
It's the limit. So what? According to central bank.
Exactly. So what happens if it's for a high risk territory? Let's just say I want to send 5 grand to Pakistan. Is that an issue?
It's because they have, you know, you have high-risk countries.
So
it's according to, if the, especially if the person is a visitor, you
send
$5,000, you
won't
allow
a
visitor to send $5,000
out. So where they get a $5,000 from a visitor? And well, I'm a cruise ship. I could be waiting on a cruise ship, and I made some money on the cruise ship, and I come here, and I
say,
yeah, there's 5 grand, I
will
send this to...
So then if you bring that inside American money, I can understand that, because you have situations where people bring in $5,000 in behavior money, but you get behavior money from a few visiting. You shouldn't have that amount of behavior money in your possession.
But if that's, you already say $5,000 is the amount, you, right, that you can send, I mean, do you question certain persons?
You have to question due diligence, KYC, because at the end of the day, when compliance come back, they ain't asking about that person, they're asking about you.
Exactly.
What did you do? What extra steps did you take?
Exactly.
Yes, you fill out a form at the end of the day, but you have a right to say, hey, I ain't feel comfortable sending this amount of money. You have a right to say that.
You brought up an interesting point, and a lot of people don't realize this. They do, complete the transaction. You reserve the right to decline a transaction. Don't just do it and then say, it was suspicious after the fact. You can decline that. Yeah? And don't wait for compliance to come in and say, as a matter of fact, there's something interesting with Central Bank report. Well, the CFATF report. And one of the things they said that with regulatory oversight, they said Central Bank was too lenient because Central Bank, they do the on-site examinations, yes? And the financial institution should have reported a suspicious activity, and they didn't report it. Central Bank came in and did their audit, and they discovered it after the fact. And Central Bank, they said, well, you know, why didn't you find it? You as the institution, like you said, do the KYC, and you could decline it, though. If it smells like a rat, looks like a rat, it's probably a rat, don't take it on. You have to have the appropriate risk appetite. Because when compliance come in, there's something in this business called, we learned this from day one in compliance. I can wait till you leave. All right. Oh, we just wait. Compliance. There is something you will learn from day one, and I know Ms. Credit Suisse will notice it in compliance. It's called CYA. Cover your assets. You can drop some letters off the last word, but you have to cover your assets. Because remember, with us, the compliance officer or the MLRO, you are regulated. You are the one who is vetted by the Central Bank, Securities Commission, the FIU. Anything go wrong, everything starts with the compliance officer. I'm at First Caribbean, and we have almost 500 staff. If something go wrong at that institution, the first point Central Bank, they don't start with the manager directly. No. They always start with the clients. You know, the eyes, the ears. And they always telling me, well, you know, we could find you, around if we could find you 20 grand. And I said, why are you always threatening me with this 20 grand? I said, if they fire me, they ain't find you 20 grand. I got no job. If you cost your institution 20 grand this morning, you think by 5 o'clock you deserve a job?
So your job is to check their work after, the tellers work after.
My work part, the compliance part of it is quality assurance. And the emphasis on the assurance that what's going through there is as best as you can clean. Don't let anything else you can say, the compliance is this and that. Compliance is a, how should I put this?
But I mean, if the teller first.
No, this is first and second and third line of defense.
Okay.
You know, they got their first line, compliance the second line.
Okay.
But then everything stops, the buck stops with you. You know, how did that happen? Did you give them adequate training? Do they have awareness? As a compliance manager officer, you gotta ensure that that's done, that they're trained to do that frontline function. So if something go wrong, they may say, okay, well, this went wrong. When's the last time they were trained? Oh, 6 years ago. Oh, you didn't train them in years, and you expect them to make mistakes, and then, so the compliance officer can be fined $20,000 by central bank. If I'm fined $20,000, the institution is fined $100,000 based on central bank policy. So if I cost the bank $100,000 this morning, you know by 5 o'clock they can let me go, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you still have
and they still go on and do something for their friend.
Well, I mean, it based on the total circumstances, I'm just being general in that regard, because I used the scenario where they didn't get any training for a while, and as a compliance officer, frontline, they should get that. So if you don't do that, that's fine. It's $100,000. And some of your big companies, they're dropping the bucket, but $100,000? I think with $20,000, I can't come up with no $20,000. I got a mortgage. So when it's $20,000, you got to pay the fine, and then I lose my job. Then what? Well, for that, definitely. No one really is going to jail. I think they stick more on the side of the $20,000. I think on the job for well, yeah. And then they're trying to make some examples right now based on this report. They said that they haven't seen convictions. Mm-hmm. You talk about all this money laundering, and it's happening. You got a lot of drugs here, we know that. A lot of stuff are being forfeited, but you know you're in the jail. So there's a what's the conviction rate? And they put pressure on us. Anytime you have international bodies putting pressure on you, saying, how come this wasn't happening, this happened? You know the notice of government, you see how fast he is moving, right? Say, why some people need to start getting in jail? All of a sudden, you're seeing MPs getting locked up. You're seeing compliance officers getting locked up. Staff getting let go, so, you know. It is what it is. I'm trying to scare you, but the compliance role is a serious role. The compliance role is very serious. That ain't nothing to take light. Because if you're the conscience of the bank, and you're the one, the watchdog, so if something go wrong, that means he wasn't watching. If you got a pit bull home and your house get broken into, and he get fired, right? All right, so I mean, when I keeping you feeding the floor, getting you water every morning and taking you on long walks, and the fellas jumping through my window and you right here licking that, boy, you need to get fired. So we know where the money comes from. It comes from good source as well as illegitimate source. To show the difference, and just in case we didn't know, there's a difference between money laundering and terrorist financing. With money laundering, it's all about that. If I'm a money launderer, anyone ever saw the movie Scarface? Mm-hmm. He made a statement in that movie, watch it again. When the fellow went to Al Pacino, Scarface, and said, you'll be moving the money down the Caribbean, and Scarface, I'm not leaving my money to no monkey down in the Bahamas. I said, why are we getting that, you know, in Bahamas bankers?
In those types of movies, they always reference
I'm not saying, I'm not sending my money down to no Bahamian monkey in the bank. I said, what the frick is this thing? Watch it again and you'll see it. You may have missed it the first time. Watch Scarface again. I said, I mean, that kind of, it is what it is. So, with the money launderers, it's all about amassing a lot of money. They all about profit. Getting that money clean and amassing profit. Terrorists, on the other hand, the end game is to advance their cause and destruction, basically. And more emphasis is placed on terrorist financing, even with penalties, because you don't want killing people. You can always replace money. You can always get money. But killing people, you ain't coming back after that. I mean, that's the second coming. And you don't need a lot of money for terrorist activity. With money laundering, it's always a lot of money. You all see these moving around. Terrorist activity, $300. You give me $300, I can probably carry the terrorist out. Just say, no, I can do it now, I don't. So, what are the international community doing? We know it's a serious issue, terrorist financing and terrorist acts. It ain't gonna stop tomorrow. Every day you turn your TV on, someone just ride a bus or drove a car to some building and load themselves. I saw the on CNN a couple of years back, this lady, she, you know, with the little, you know, this way all black and the only little eye open. And she raised up the cloak and she, click. And then they cut the news because they say it's too graphic. How the hell you blow yourself up? I mean, what's the last thing go through your mind when you press that button? I don't get that. But, and they always say that these terrorists, they say, you know, if you go back to Allah, and you'll get seven celestial virgins, and you'll get this, and you'll be honored in the afterlife, and all of that. So, international strategy, the FATF, that's the Financial Action Task Force, it's the international standard bearer. This is this group of G9. International, the big major industrialized countries got together. They said, we're the industrial powers of the world. You know, we need the standard for the world. And this is what people need to do. And these are the recommendations to counteract anti-money laundering and terrorist financing. So they provide the standards. And you know, they're powerful. Because when they make the standards, the whole world got to adapt. You don't have to. I mean, you don't have to. But for us, as a financial sector, a major financial house, we have to. Our life depends on that. So they came up with these recommendations, you know, with the 49 recommendations plus 5. Recommendation 5 indicates that countries should criminalize terrorist financing. They're not saying you could have, would have, should have. They say, we strongly suggest you do it. And whenever you hear they say stuff like that, that means, well, you better do it. I heard some politicians that they say, oh, they're talking about we need to do this, the proliferation of mass destruction and all that stuff. Oh, we'll never do that. No, really? What's the fast legislation to pass on that? Anytime they say we ain't gonna never do that, listen, yeah, we depend on the United States. The United States is part of FATF. And if they say you need to do this, you can do it. You have to do it. So it's a criminal offense based on the FATF recommendation to harbor terrorists and their funds. So the whole world has to comply. Yeah? So when they make it an international standard to criminalize it, it's trickled down to the various territories and regions, and it goes to the various government bodies and the various central banks, financial service commissions, whatever, then there's the financial industry, and we all have to comply. But it trickles down based on what they have to say. Amazing, right? That's a lot of power, right? The United States Patriot Act, and you all remember 9/11, and George Bush, this junior, the Patriot Act came up. The Patriot Act, the full name of it is the Providing Appropriate Tools Required to Intercept and Obstruct Terrorism Act, 2001. This act is very powerful. How powerful? When the 9/11 took place, I was with, we were at the FIU. They sent an order worldwide that we need to find out if any of those places on that list have accounts in any of those foreign financial institutions. Well, the United States sent that out to all the countries. And at the FIU, they sent us a list, and we had like thousands of names. We had to go to all the financial institutions asking, do you have this place in there? And we had to provide a response in 1 year. So we were making some overtime. We didn't have to do it. But the United States said, you have to do this. The Patriot Act demanded we do that. And there would have been a fine. And the question always posed to me is this, but in the United States, how could they fine us? Well, they can. They'll say, we're going to fine you $1 million for not complying with the Patriot Act. And we don't have to comply. But you know what they'll do? They'll cut us off from the United States financial system. So that means we can't operate in U.S. dollars. So what happens if we can't operate in U.S. dollars? We're dead in the water, right?
Yeah.
So it ain't like we could have, should have. We can say, we ain't dirty. You know what you get when our prime minister say, we're not going to do it. You hear me? We're not going to go and do whatever. Yeah? You get cut off. The FIU, this act was in 2001. The FIU was already around. They had, it was already in the ground, in the works. We were operating out of a drug enforcement unit, Thompson Boulevard. But it really got the highlight after the 9/11. But it was there. The legislation, we gave it teeth in the powers, yeah, but it was there, yeah.
So it was only the police then?
Yeah.
But now it's a body of different
person. Well, the FIU, it has police officers and it has civilians, attorney and all that stuff. But you had, like how they have the spy bill, they were doing it, but you didn't have the legislation to give it teeth and powers. It's there, you can do all that stuff, but you need that legislation. They didn't have that for the FIU. But after 9/11 and prior to that, they had all this stuff going on. They said, you know what, we need it. And then you had pressure from Parrish. You remember the blacklisting? They said the Bahamas doesn't have an FIU. That was one of the recommendations. How you all don't FIU? That was part of the reason for us getting blacklisted too. And they say we were not cooperating enough, giving enough information. They say we were a tax haven. We were all about secrecy, hiding people's funds and illicit funds. They wrote a whole telephone book on us, stuff we ain't doing. And we got blacklisted. Now we're getting threatened now again with whitelist. And they got so much list. They got the gray list, the blacklist is a kiss of death. Then there's the gray list, there's the whitelist. And then you don't see IRS coming. So it's like the benchmark moves every other year. So it is what it is. I mean, you can say we ain't gonna do it, but then you operate British pounds or euros. So what if they cut you, what then? You down me, do down me, though. United States already got you. The EU got you. Unless we got another, we ain't got oil. So let me pick up the pace again. So the United States Patriot Act, it's, like I said, it's far-reaching. That's why it says, it's called the United States Patriot Act in U.S. extraterritorial. That means it's worldwide reach. So if they want information from you, they can quote the Patriot Act and say, hey, you need that information. And they can force you. Or what they would do, they would sanction us. What happened, 75% of our tourists come from North America. So if they put an advisory on us, an embargo on us, we don't need to be in Cuba. I feel sorry for Cuba. Because that being in existence before most of you and here were born, and you put that embargo on there. So we can't afford that.
So with the with the USA Patriot Act, did all countries have to sign an agreement with them, or
no.
It's just that? Because
no,
that's the sign, it's automatic that you have to comply.
Well, you choose not to. Uh-huh. It's legislation that implemented by the United States.
They could use it.
And they said, we will go worldwide to get information, and if you don't comply, we'll use sanctioning mechanisms.
Okay.
So they say, you ain't got to, you can't come to my yard no more. Or you ain't play with my ball no more. You ain't watch my cable no more. Or I can be your friend no more. And we can't have the United States alienate us, because we need them for protection. We need them for the tourists. We need them for, you remember 9/11? If you remember 9/11, we didn't have flights coming in or going out for almost a week.
Yeah.
And the food stores were looking so empty. We can't go 2 weeks without food coming from the United States. 2 weeks. We don't grow nothing.
I don't marijuana.
I mean, because we don't grow nothing. But I mean, I see the trees.
But, that's why we need to grow our own stuff.
Continue with the international strategy. The European Union, they have a strategy where they have a European Union terrorist list. They would put names on a list if they deem those persons or designate them. So that every time they got one, they keep adding to the list. And you got hundreds of thousands of names. A recommendation, if your institution have an automated system, or how do you scrub against those names to ensure that you're not moving monies or receiving money from those persons? We have one at Twist Group. It's a tedious process at times, but we have what we call hits. They may have a name that's close, because they had a name one time and it sounded like that. Anytime you hear the name Muhammad, I don't care what you name, it can be in it. I mean, I ain't trying to pick on no one, right? What about your bing? I was like, what, you got hit? Yeah. I said, what do you name, Muhammad? Because we got like 50,000 Muhammads in here. Like, damn, name Muhammad. I said, you got to go check that to make sure your name. And the challenge is this. With the Muhammads, you can have hundreds and hundreds,
right,
millions of them. South America is an issue for us. When you got those poison named Hector, Garcia Mendoza. Even his name may be Hector Mendoza Garcia, and the names you in the place. And then you take on the name of the father and sometimes the mother. It can be a partial hit, and you're like, damn, how much Hector Garcia in the world? And you like, when you hit check the hits, you're like, 100 hits? You're like, damn, I gotta go through this to figure out who. Then you gotta request passport and just to make sure they're the same person. It's epic. It's crazy when you deal with the South Americans, and I tell you, boy, they ain't no fun, but they. So, in the European Union, they have the terrorist list or watch list. And you could actually go online to see the list, the listing. The cash control regulation requires the disclosure of cash equivalent in excess of $10,000 when entering or leaving the EU. So when you go in or you're going out, you have to declare. We declare here whenever we taking out $110,000 or more. Failure to do that, you can have the money forfeited. But we don't have a system, let's say, where we actually have all of that, capture all of that information. We have had something at the GFSR, that's the regulators and the financial institutions, where we wanted to, this is back in 2010, they wanted the system where all transactions, $10,000 or more, you would have filed those at the end of the day. Now, I know you're getting started or something like that, but it'll be done electronically, and it'll be sent to the central bank. They do it in Jamaica. They call it TTR, Threshold Transaction Reports. Anything at the threshold amount, let's say it's $10,000, after we report at the end of the day.
But so even central bank is still not that way, because they got to give you the proof.
You can get information, but they having that readily available to give to, let's just say, your CFIUS. You got to go to this one, you got to go to that one. Central Bank, we just had a meeting with them yesterday, and they said, we have a lot of work to do. As a matter of fact, there's going to be a meeting on the 30th of November. Anyone here is the MLRO? On the 30th of November, they have a new unit coming in the Central Bank called the AML ATF unit. That's going to be rolling out before the year end because of the same report. And CFIUS is coming back in 2018. So we have to have all those deficiencies remediated. So we need to have this unit. That's a short time, I know. You're coming right back. So you don't, because if you don't, we can go on a white list.
Yeah.
And they're always tracking you with the list.
So the white list is
the white list is the lower level. It's the black list when you don't want to touch it. That's how we got black list. So if you go on the gray list, that means we can touch you. The white list, yeah, you only got the mumps. We can talk to you. But the black list, no. Even if it comes in your yard, you don't want a black list. You try to avoid the gray list. The white list, you might get deal with it. We don't want to be on no list. That means whenever you get listed, that means you have to do some stuff to get off the list, to remediate. And it's costly. You got to train people, you got to put programs in place, you got to have legislation, all that. Yeah? So they have this stuff here. The commission promotes cooperation between FIUs, where they can share information by way of confidential from FIU to FIU. The commission provides guidelines to protect the sector. So they provide guidelines, the communication and information sharing with FIUs. Ending the 10,000, entering or leaving the terrorist watch list. So all of those are mechanisms they use to help counter terrorist funding in the European Union. Yeah? Then we come to sanctions. What are sanctions? Sanctions and embargoes are tools mainly put in place by the UN, really. Regional bodies such as the European Union or any individual country, for example, the United States. You know they can sanction you too. Against a country, a jurisdiction or organization believed to be violating or threatening to violate international law. Prime example, North Korea. North Korea, you know the little show I fell on. It's called, what Trump has called him?
Rocket Man.
Say Rocket Man trying to make, he wants nuclear weapons. He said North Korea wants to be a nuclear power. They said we have the resources, we have the numbers. We want nuclear weapons too. We want to be right up there with the United States and Soviet Union, so we want nuclear weapons. Have people starving in the country. You mean you know, people out of job and you want nuclear weapons? But anyhow, that's them. So he's building that on United Nations. You know, United Nations was created after World War II. It's a peacekeeping mission, you know? And they are encouraging people to get involved and getting all these nuclear weapons for the global world and all that stuff. But he wants to have these weapons. And he's testing his weapons already. He said his dream is to fire a nuclear weapon from North Korea to the United States. You ain't got nothing better to do it. I mean, how do you just sit down all day, just, you know, every day you saw the news, every day he's just testing and just trying to get closer and closer. And every time he gets a little closer to the United States, he has a big party. He gets all this military and they have a parade and we're getting closer. It's crazy. They have a function. And the people so brainwashed, you know, they're like, yeah, they have to marry. Yeah, he would kill them or you go missing, yeah, but that's crazy. But it is what it is. So they have sanctioned this country, primarily economic sanctions against them. Trade. The only people who really trade with them right now is China. And you hear President Trump saying, you know, China need to put more pressure on them. Now, hey, these people still building these weapons and stuff, and I need to, you know, cut off some trade with them, you know, so they could get the message to stop making these nuclear weapons. Stop test firing these weapons, pointed at the United States. Because that's almost like declaring war. Because if you in your yard and your neighbor every day, he got his shotgun, pow! I try and see how close I can get to your house. Shoot, so I gotta get a bigger shotgun, pow! I get closer, I mean, like that's, he's declaring war on you, right?
Yes.
And you gotta protect yourself, right? You know, or do something with that neighbor. However. So sanctions are normally used by the international community for more of one of the following reasons: suppression of terrorist activity. Because you know they got like some countries with actually sponsor terrorist activity. Yeah, you have like even Pakistan at one point was a big terrorist hub. With sanctions against them being rescinded. You have Iran and Iraq. They have sanctions against them because a lot of terrorists come from Iran and Iraq, and the United States has sanctioned them. Application of pressure to comply with set objectives. You heard of the deal that the President Obama made with the is it Iraq? Iran, sorry, Iran. They would give them training and weaponry and all that stuff, so they would just stop doing their nuclear program because they wanted to have nuclear weapons too. So President Obama said, "Yeah, we're gonna open some trade with you. We're gonna train you, give you weapons and all that stuff, but you gotta." Who even this idea that you want nuclear weapons? Why everyone will have the capacity to blow up the world? I'm just trying to figure out why. Why is it that you wake up every morning, you know, I got the power to blow up the world? So, enforcement to their diplomatic efforts fail, because if you got someone who decided, look, yeah, I can just chop you up, you know. And he said that every day, and you just trying to give him a little olive branch every day. At some point, you can stop eating the olive branch, right? So that at some point you can go to Kelly's and buy your cutlass too, right? So sanctions are used whenever diplomatic efforts fail. And that's the route they're taking right now in North Korea. Because you know they're saying, you know, hey, cease this program. But he's still testing every other weekend, he's just firing off these weapons. So at some point, they gotta make a call that, you know, hey, maybe we need to, but you know how the CIA is operating. One day, Kim Jong-il may just go missing. You're not his operating. America's quite dirty too now. Oh, ain't no sense there. To encourage a change in behavior, again, this rogue behavior, they call North Korea a rogue nation. So you want to get a change in behavior, maybe you want to sanction them. And it's another way of cutting them off from the rest of the world. And you see it in Cuba. Cuba has some cars right now you can't find parts for. That's when the United States cut them off from the rest of the world. Anyone been to Cuba? In here? They got some cars. They look good now, and there's antique-looking cars.
Oh, cars, yeah.
They look antique because you can't find parts for them, and that's all they got. Yeah, but in Cuba, they got some buildings that look like you going in another time era.
Yeah.
Because like time stopped when they got sanctioned, and they cut off from the world, and that's where they stopped.
They're still running.
They have makeshift parts, but I mean, you remember now, President Obama, he said before he demit office, he's gonna open the borders to Cuba, and they're gonna be, you know, welcome back into the fold. He left office, a new president came in, he said he's gonna build walls. So what's the difference? One wanna open the border, the next one wanna build walls. So who are you going with?
He ain't gonna be there too much longer.
So sanctions, they pretty much work like that to encourage you to get in line with international best practice. And it's a way of pressuring you, especially when diplomatic efforts fail. Several sanctioned countries, this is a list. I don't have to go to Afghanistan. Cuba is highlighted in red for a reason. Iran, Lebanon, Syria, Zimbabwe, Somalia. You always hear about the Somali warlords. Anyone watch Captain Phillips?
Yes.
Yeah? So those are the Somalians, they all they do is just go on little boats, see if they can find shipping vessel, normally freighters, to terrorize. And normally it's for ransom. We hold you hostage. And if you want to see her again, you want to see Miss Credit Suisse again, you send me $50 million. Just do it from a fishing village. It is what it is. But the list can be found online on the UN site. Again, with the sanctions, there are two broad categories that concern with trade, economic, and arms sanctions. They block certain monetary or trade dealings with countries or regions. And this is deterring them from producing or experimenting with their weapons. And this is against North Korea, that trade on economic sanctions. Then you have the special designated SDN listing. You normally see that with OFAC. I'm talking about with OFAC. And the 9 persons list. It's like you and your little group of friends, because you're behaving bad, they say, you know what? We don't play with you no more. I don't want Tasha around me no more. You all agree? We agree. Tasha, you can't come around us no more. So when you see us on the playground, don't even approach us. You know, you being blackboard. Okay? So when you start behaving uppity like us, then you hang with us, okay? Now there's people around me. You know what I mean, man? So they have a lot of lists, which brings us to OFAC. This is what the United States uses. So the Office of Foreign Asset Control is a part of the United States Department of Treasury. And they use this to sanction countries that go against international United States interests. And these are countries that are probably involved in terrorists, financing international narcotics trafficking. Anything that goes against the United States foreign policy, they use OFAC. Processing transactions are discovered to be OFAC related. If you got a hit at your financial institution for someone who may be on the OFAC list and it's going through the United States system, you can be fined. Okay? And people always ask me the question, but me in the Bahamas, it's going through our accounts. If you have a US dollar account and you send a transaction, you can be fined. This is the part where I can tell you my story. I had an experience I don't want to ever go through again. I was doing some sanction screening at work. And there was a particular client. He looked at his transactions 99 times, and I just looked at it, do all the checks and all that stuff, approve, go ahead, send it to the dumb wire, go ahead, you know. The 100th time, because you saw the name, it was a slight change. Remember, you know the South American names? It was a slight change. I just saw the name and I said, approve. I gotta go to that. 99 times. Going on vacation after that. So I go on vacation now. I'm in the jungle shack now, trying to get my costume together. I get a call. See, that's strange. My boss called me all the way from Cayman. Hey, what was up? Hey, Randy, I'm not running a name by you. That's strange. All right. She said, you know this name? I said, yeah, I know the name. She said, okay. It came back as a positive hit, positive match. The OFAC sanction list that you process. Wow. The interesting thing that she said to me was after that, she said, boy, I really hate to lose you. I said, when you say lose me, you mean like fire? So I started trying to register all this, you on vacation, I think, and I just start thinking of my mortgage. And then she doesn't tell me, you know, I hate to lose you, you know. I said, lose me like fire? I mean, like, I don't? She said, yeah, because. She said that you know, you just caused the bank potentially a fine of $250,000. So I was like, mother, you know, I mean, I would, my stomach broke down when she said that. And I was like, nah. So when she told me that, she said, you know what? I called in a favor in Toronto, and he works something out to get you off. But just remember this: I own you for the rest of your time at First Caribbean. All right?
Oh, wow.
I said, mother. So she said, I own you. Anything I tell you to do, you will jump through hoops for me. You will run through a brick wall for me. I said, nah. She retires like 2 years. So the dance pair. Because of the name. The he didn't use the full name. And it didn't. Sometimes you get what we call partial match or partial hits. You could have, like, I'm Randy Taylor. The data boy may not line up, but you may get a full match. You got Randy Alonzo Taylor, and there's some other information that lined up with that on the sanction list. Positive match, but I only saw the Randy Taylor. I said, I know this place, and it's the same transaction, but I said, yeah, I approve it. Compliance approves a lot of stuff. Everyone know that. You get paid for your signature and compliance. So if something go wrong, compliance sign off on that. So that's why I always say CYA. I learned from that. I learned from that before you sign, check 3 times. Look at it. I don't send emails no more. I send emails to myself, especially those angry emails. Then I come back and I look at it again. And boy, no, that's too strong. I think that'll take it. Because you got to be careful what you send. Staff is used that against you too. Because when you tell a staff, go ahead and approve, that's why I tweak stuff like, I'll say something along the lines of, once a research is being conducted and poison is not appearing on the line, not appearing on the sanction listing, and there's no other additional adverse information that you would have discovered doing your poison checks, then you can go ahead and transact it.
So you cover
yourself. I cover myself. You CYA. So when the thing hit the fire, me and them going home.
Oh,
You have to. Because once you just come back one line to prove, staff will come back and they'll say, see ya, apply, say approve. Yeah, I say approve based on if this was followed. And you didn't follow that. So if I got in home, that'll be too hard leaving the parking lot. You know, you can't be no fool now. Forget I got a mortgage. So Cuba. We can be back on Cuba real quick. The United States continues to maintain a sanction against Cuba, despite the recent easing of tension between the two countries. Remember Obama? He visited there. That's the first sitting president to visit in many years. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm going to open the border. He promised the Fidel Diagno. He said, we can be doing this. Trump came and he said, you know what? Everything what Obama said, I ain't none of that. We can do big things. You know, he don't use a lot of big words. Yeah. We can do big things. Yeah. And we can make a big wall. Everything's going to be big. And mm-hmm. He don't make words. You know? So what you can remember when it comes down to Cuba, because Cuba is interesting because of proximity and because we see it a lot. We got Cuban nationals who live here too. We have an embassy here too, an ambassador. Oh, no. We ain't that. As soon as I see transaction with Cuban, I get my attention. When a Cuban comes to open the account, I say, let's get something straight. You can open the account. The money what you make here, it's staying here. Now, if you want to send some money back home, you can do it in Canadian, whatever. You can send it in Deutsch. You can send it in pesos. You can send it in rocks. It ain't going to be in U.S. dollars. Yeah? Because you leave with me in a funny situation. Can't have that. So when it comes down to Cubans, general rule, persons from other countries can freely visit and transact with Cuba, provided that no U.S. dollars are involved. Yeah? Because the United States have a sanction, economic embargo against them. And that ain't going to leave no time during Trump's time.
So I'm in Cuba, and I get in trouble. Can my relatives send money still?
The rule of thumb has always been this. You cannot, as a U.S. citizen, for OFAC purposes, it can't be for Cuban government, Cuban interests, U.S. persons. You can't. But you're not U.S. person. Yeah? You could take it, send money there. It ain't gonna be in U.S. dollars.
Well, I mean, U.S. dollars.
How you can get that? However you want to go with it. Let me speak for voice Caribbean. It ain't happening with us. Now, the other institution in here, what do?
I can tell you,
however you can do that and convert it. Canadian is not an issue. The other issue, currency is not an issue. But it's the chance and the likelihood. I almost get sent home for missing the half of my name. The fact that a transaction get processed, you know I got it home. I don't need to be home. At least.
If you have a mortgage.
I got a mortgage. I ain't got no house. Another thing with the Cuban sanctions, I can talk real quick. This embargo went into effect in 1960. Most of us weren't born yet. You know, I wasn't around in 1960. Still exists today. How long are you going to keep the people down? Yeah? The Cuban sanction restrict persons subject to U.S. jurisdiction, individual entities from engaging in transactions and other activities involving Cuba. Once you get in Cuba, there was a transaction that came across my desk and it triggered an alert because we had an automated system. It had the name of Havana in it. It's not in Cuba, really. It's a place in, I think it's St. Louis, Missouri. Name of honor. I didn't know there was some place in there that triggered, beep, beep. You got to look at this. And I said, well, okay, that ain't really Cuba. I'm scared. We're like, what? Because once you hear a name like Castro, Havana, Cuba, those names, just like Muhammad, automatic. All persons subject to U.S. jurisdiction include all persons in the United States, all U.S. citizens and permanent residents, wherever located in the world, all persons engaged in transactions and more property or not otherwise subject to the jurisdiction of the United States. So once you're a U.S. person, green card holder or whatever, that's subject to you, you're subject to that too. You ain't doing no transaction, U.S. dollars, earmarked for Cuba, Cuban nationals, and Cuban government, Cuban interests. There are some restrictions. If you can get approval from OFAC themselves, they do give some leeway for medical purposes, emergency purposes, yeah. That's not automatic. It's a case by case. They may say, okay, you got what, 2 days to live? Okay, we'll sanction it. They'll sign off on it. But you outside of that, if you don't get that approval, ain't that. So I'd be able to rule of thumb for us at First Caribbean, and I only reference it because I worked this, that ain't that happening when it comes to you. We just ain't gonna take that chance. We don't have that risk appetite. $250,000, who going before the board and say, it costs us $250,000? Really? Oh, thanks for letting us know. You cleaned it there, so yeah. Oh, trust me, this get ready for us now. Swipe card and park. So the parking squad is taking the place of name off the nameplate. I mean, name it and try it. Oh, yeah. Anyhow, that's the thing. So, implication for not performing effective screening. Remember I told you, you had to do the sanction screening? Mm-hmm. Ensure that this ain't the right poison and this is the right poison. You're going to be required to do that in compliance, just to make sure. And of course, check it twice or three times. International banks must comply with UN, ARC, CIMA, Criminal Code, FATFOR, EF, it's all these different sanctions and stuff you gotta know. So when you're dealing with it, I have cheat sheets at work. And I would tell the team, hey, did you check the EU list? Yeah, we checked that. Did you do a world check? Okay, yeah, we checked that. Did you check this list? You checked that. A lot of it is automated, but a lot of it is hands-on just to cover yourself. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And sometimes you could slip and not remember, like, nah, banking ain't easy, you know. But you get a hit and you gotta check all these various lists. So what we do, we have all those systems and the programs open. So when you're running, you have a little checklist, ticking it off. It's okay to check that list, this, you know. And once you're confident, then you go ahead. And the business don't understand this. They're like, why is the client taking so long to come back? You only come back to me in 2 minutes. I said, buddy, I check in the list. Well, how long are you going to take? Really? So when I say approve, and then the dual name show up on the list, let me tell you, give me another example. A customer came in the bank the other day. So they wanted to send $10,000 to China. I said, okay, why you all come, you know, and the only thing I was looking at the instructions and I was trying to figure out what it was all about, because, you know, 10,000, okay, this stuff. I don't know what China, why you send 10,000 in a car. You know, the only thing you buy from there. I got familiar with a new word, something called $10,000 worth of something called Indian ready.
I was like,
you ain't got credit, you know. I said, yeah, let me check it. And I go on the Google, what the hell is Indian Remy? Find out that's him. Who's buying $10,000 worth of him?
It's a black guy.
I don't know better. So I was like, yeah, it's a freaking Indian Remy. That might be an explosive or something. I don't know. So I was scared.
That's famous.
After hearing what Indian Remy was, and then they had an invoice, and then they say that they supply one or two beauties. I didn't get all that information. They just say the customer want to get $10,000 for Indian Remy, and I was like, what the hell, Indian Remy? So I was golden crap. Ain't a lot of classes, you know. So sanctions are strict liability, criminal offenses, meaning you don't have to prove nothing. That's like, you run the red light. You should know better. So you ain't got to prove nothing. Yeah? So that's when you hear something say strict liability, straightforward. That's basically what it means. So it's like, you go and process it. You ain't got no case to answer. Because that's straightforward. You were convicted. That kind of it. So that's why you only pressure me to say prove. And then sign off. And then next thing you know, Indian Remy was explosive and I didn't know no better. Regulators worldwide have intensified the focus on banks, which need to demonstrate that they have in place adequate and effective measures to perform these screenings. So you have to be able to demonstrate. And central bank comments, they say, how do you screen? Well, we have an automated system. Well, we have to review invoices. We need to know that this is a client of ours. We need to know the nature of their business with the papers. The requisition forms are completed. So you can check and balance, you know? You have to basically do KYC. And when necessary, do EDD, enhanced due diligence. EDD is really KYC on steroids. You have your basic client, but then you have the high-risk client, so you have to go above and beyond. You got to get additional information. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you've got someone in another jurisdiction, possibly high-risk. So